Martin Patera is managing partner at Edison Innovation, a lot of experience with projects, and he deals with the question on how to transform a classical product into an integrated digital business model. There is a real case example from a leading medical technology company. With this presentation, we also, or Martin plans to do a little survey so with Mentimeter. So would be great if all of you can join. So it's always exciting to see these real-time surveys emerging in real time. So there are a few questions, and if you could take part with your mobile phone maybe, or you switch to your browser, that would be great. So Martin, can you hear me? There is no sound.
Can you hear me now? I
Yes, now
think
I can hear you.
it worked now.
So yeah,
Okay.
please go ahead.
Thank you, Sven. Thank you for this nice introduction and for raising the expectations. The question and the poll will be happening in about 20 minutes, where I will have a question to you, and that will then also be part of our Q&A. Let me introduce myself very briefly. I'm Martin. I'm based in Austria, actually in Vienna, and a little bit also in the mountains now during the lockdown. Yeah, I have 20 years of experience in innovation in different industries like machinery engineering, mobility, transportation, financial services, and medical devices. And what I appreciated most during these years was the innovators that I was able to work with, and all the inspiration that I got, from marketing, product teams, service teams, digital transformation teams. And I would use this opportunity today to give back and to also share some of that inspiration with you now, especially when it becomes more complex, when innovation becomes more complex, and you reach a point where you realize that product innovation is just not enough anymore. And then it goes beyond the innovation of a classical product. And this is what I would like to share with you. To start that, to put in the first question of my presentation here. So I need to share that. That should work now. I hope you can see. Yeah, that should work. How to transform a classical product into an integrated digital business model. To be able to do that, I would like to give a first question to the whole thing: how to build a business. So beyond product, how to build a business. And I would like to introduce very briefly what you probably already know and already have been working with. The business model canvas. I really like that that concept, as it really helps to structure the problem as a starting point for innovation. So when we look at the description of a business model, it has nine building blocks. The first one is customers and customer segments. The second one is the value proposition. So what is being delivered and offered to those customers? Then we have channels, distribution channels and sales channels. We have customer relationships that we need to consider in a business, and revenue streams. So where are revenues come from? Do they come from? We heard about that in the previous presentation from Julia, which I really appreciated. You need to come up with a pricing model that will work. What are key resources that we need to have in a business that cannot be shared and that need to be there as a resource for running the business? What are key activities? What is it that we need to do ultimately to make the business run? And what key partners are needed? What about the innovation ecosystem? What are key partners that will make sure that our business will work? And finally, the cost structure. Together with revenues, they define the profit formula. Now, having said all of that, what you can say is we can structure a business like this to make it somehow, you know, operational. Experience tells that the value proposition is definitely the most critical factor for any kind of business model innovation. If you cannot get that one right, the whole model will never fly. And now I would like to enter this case example from medical industry with the guiding question, how to innovate that business? How to innovate the blood sugar meter business? And you do not need to have to be out of that industry to understand the example. And I will show you in a few minutes how this can be approached now based on the understanding of what is involved in a business and how we can make this more operational. And a starting point, as I already said, a good starting point is to map out the existing business model based on the product, the service that's already in place, and to put that in the center of that canvas and to say, okay, we have here a value proposition that's blood sugar meters. And now the tricky question comes, okay, but how to innovate that? How to make this digital? How to make use of all these, you know, new technologies? How to innovate? And to start that discussion, and that is what I want to share with you, it is good to shift the perspective away from the product that is currently in place towards the underlying need of the customers, which we call the job to be done. Here in this example, it shall not be the drill that we focus on in innovation when we want to create a new business. It is the underlying job to be done. What is the reason why people use the drill, the product, the blood sugar meter? And this opens up a totally new arena for innovation and for discussion also in a team and with customers. In the background of what I will show you now is this process. We call this the outcome-driven innovation process that operationalizes this way of thinking in a very clear-cut strategy and innovation process. I will not go into all of these steps here and really cut that one short into three guiding questions. And these three guiding questions are, first of all, who is the customer? Do we really know who the customer is that we want to create value for? And especially not easy question when you're in an ecosystem, in a market ecosystem with many different types of customers. But this is something that we need to discuss. First of all, who is the customer that we want to create value for? The second question is, what are the unmet customer needs? What is it really that these customers want to have? What is relevant for them and not well served with existing solutions? And based on these inputs, these two answers for the first two questions, we can work on designing and creating a sustainable value proposition in the center of that business model. On the right-hand side, the need, on the left-hand side, the solution. And this is also part of the philosophy, separate the solution from the need, separate the drill from the hole in the wall. Now, who is the customer and how can this be answered? Let me again show you this example of the blood sugar meter business. When we look at the healthcare market, we can see many, as we call them, job executors there. You have, of course, diabetics. So these are the patients that need to have these blood sugar meters. But you also have physicians, you have caregivers, you have educators, insurance companies that need to pay for those devices, and also manufacturer representatives who need to maintain stuff and maintain products that are out in the field. So where to innovate and which of those customer groups to focus on? And there is a guiding recommendation is to ask oneself, what is the ultimate reason for doing the whole business? And that will guide us into the direction of, why we are here, why we are doing that business at all, why do we manufacture blood sugar meters? And ultimately, in this case, yes, that's the patients, that's the diabetics. Having said that, that does not mean that we should neglect all the others, but they are probably in terms of priority on a different level then. Ultimately, of course, we want to know all the needs of all these types of customers. But if we have this kind of guiding principle, first of all, focus on the ultimate executor who will have the ultimate benefit out of a solution. Now, if we are there and we have identified a group of customers that we want to create value for, we also want to identify this job to be done, that this customer wants to get done, this group of customers want to get done. And here's a first trap. And the first trap is that we may tend to define the job to be done as the technical function of the existing product. In this case, a blood sugar meter, yeah, what is the job? Measure blood sugar. And that's probably a trap and probably not true when it comes to innovation. So probably that is a little bit too narrow. And here is the recommendation. Don't ask what job does my product do, but instead of that, ask what job is the customer trying to get done. So what is the reason why this product is used at all? What is the underlying need? And when we do that here for blood sugar meters, we probably realize that people just don't want a blood sugar meter at all. What they ultimately want to achieve, what the underlying need is, they want to maintain their blood sugar level in a desired range. So that is the underlying job to be done why these products are being used. And if we go to a higher flight level in our job definition, like not measuring blood sugar, but maintaining blood sugar levels in a desired range, we have a very good basis to start with and to start to understand the needs that are aligned to that job to be done. This is the second question. What are the unmet customer needs? Now, when it comes to keeping blood sugar levels in a desired range, what are the unmet customer needs? And here we use a so-called job map model. So a job map, I will tell you what it is not a customer journey. A job map details step by step what the customer is trying to get done, not necessarily what they are doing. So this is a picture of an ideal situation. What is it that people are trying to achieve when they want to get a job done? And therefore, it is solution independent, and it details the ideal process flow and applies across geographies. Now, how does this look like here? When it comes to maintaining blood sugar level in a range, people want to determine the therapy needs. They want to understand alternative therapy approaches, set up an individual therapy, validate the therapy settings, then keep the blood sugar level in the range. That is, so to say, then the core element of the job. But when they do that, they also want to be able to monitor the effectiveness of their therapy, adjust the therapy if needed, and keep track of therapy adaptations. Now, when we have understood that job to be done completely, we can also map existing solutions against that. So that's, so to say, the ideal situation and the job that the customer wants to get done. And when we look at our existing product now, this blood sugar meter, it will support a step of that job to be done, and that is the monitoring step when it comes to really identifying blood sugar levels and the actual range and level. And when we have this in place, this already serves within a team of innovators as an aligning picture and a vision for the future. A future vision would be to come up with a solution platform that get the whole job done on a single platform and get it done better and faster. Now, how can we measure that? There are three ways to get a job done better. First of all, people want to get the job done, any job done, faster. Second, people want to have less errors, less variability when getting the job done. And they want to achieve a higher output and a higher throughput. Now, these are the three parameters, three criteria that we can use, metrics that we can use to measure the success in getting a job done. We call that desired outcomes. Now, what we want to do now is we want to understand these desired outcomes along the whole job map. So for each step of the job, we want to understand what costs them a lot of time, what can go wrong, and what limits their throughput and output. And this then gives us, yeah, a job map with all the outcome statements inside. Typically, we will find approximately 150 to 200 such outcome statements spread over the whole job map. And I want to give you this one example here, an outcome, a desired outcome when it comes to monitoring effectiveness of the therapy would be that people want to minimize the time it takes to determine the current blood sugar level. That is actually being supported by the blood sugar meter, but mind here, it does not mention the blood sugar meter. It doesn't mention any kind of technology, any kind of solution that is already here or will be here in the future. It just mentions how solutions are being measured by the customers and being measured in getting the job done. Another example would be that when it comes to determining the therapy needs, people want to minimize the time it takes to assess at what time during the day blood sugar levels are frequently out of range. And you see that you do not need to be an expert for blood sugar meters or for diabetes care to understand these need statements. So a need statement must be formulated in a very clear-cut style so that everybody can understand it without any further explanations. And free of solutions, free of technology. So this makes sure that these statements are really valid over time and stay the same over a long period of time. Another example here, minimize the likelihood when it comes to validating therapy settings. People want to minimize the likelihood of not being aware of the relations between diet, physical activities, and medication to keep the blood sugar level in the desired range. Now, when you look at those statements, they are probably not being addressed with existing blood sugar meters and probably cannot be addressed with future blood sugar meters. Probably, if you want to address these things, we need to come up with new solution platforms. And this is what this needs analysis can tell us right away. But that's not enough. One more thing is missing. We want to understand the priorities. Out of these 200 outcomes, desired outcomes around the whole job map, which of those are the most important ones that we should innovate on? And for that, we want to measure importance and satisfaction with each of these needs with a large group of job executors, with a large group of customers. That's a questionnaire, a schematic example here that delivers this kind of opportunity landscape. And now this opportunity landscape shows us on these two axes, on the importance axis, the horizontal line, and the satisfaction on the vertical, importance and satisfaction, and it shows what needs are underserved for the large majority of customers, what needs are overserved that are not so important but extremely well served with existing solutions. So we see both sides of the innovation medal here. Where do we need to increase value? Where do we need to increase performance? And where can we probably lower performance and lower the cost for delivering a service and a product? And this runs into disruptive innovation approaches when we look at the overserved needs. And once we have the data in place, we can, you know, play with the data and analyze it more deeply and understand hidden patterns in these answerings of these clients. And by doing so, we discover and uncover hidden segments of customers. If you would like that term, different types of personas, different types of people that have different needs, priorities. And here we can see that this market is split into three large groups. One group, the very on the very right hand side, that is highly underserved with existing solutions, where everything is extremely important. Especially this one need statement that I took out here as an example, minimize the time it takes to determine the current blood sugar level. While we see another large group in that market where this outcome statement is not of relevance at all and overserved with existing solutions. So based on this input here, we have set the basis for an aligned discussion with all team members in an organization, be it from marketing, from product management, from digital transformation teams, to business model innovation teams, to sit together, look at that opportunity landscape, and come up with measures and a strategy on how to address this market. And this is when we enter the discussion on what is a sustainable value proposition. And have a look at this example here. These inputs on the customer side, like what customer segments do we have? What is it that the customers really want? We can now use to challenge the existing value proposition of the business, which is so far blood sugar meters. And you already can see the question mark here. Now, how can we now develop this new value proposition? Again, we look at the job map and we give two questions. First of all, how can we get more of the job done on a future single platform? And the second question is, how can we get the job done better and cheaper? Better means faster, less errors, better throughput, yes, and cheaper. And these are the guiding questions on creating such a value proposition. Then, what came out here in Faroche Diabetes Care is what I want to share here. It's a new value proposition of an integrated, personalized diabetes management. And this value proposition includes different types of products. On the one hand, it's not the blood sugar meter anymore alone. It's sensors that can measure blood sugar values on a continuous basis, saving the diabetic a lot of time in measuring blood sugar values. Now, this would be, so to say, the direct extrapolation of the existing product by adding a sensor and adding an automatic function. On the other hand, Roche bought startup companies, for example, MySugar. This is the app that you can see here. And that helps the diabetic to better track their therapy settings and their therapy resites. It's kind of a diary that you have here. And many other products. Now this value proposition is, so to say, a long-term roadmap for product development, service development, and also for the creation of strategic partners. Because you will also realize in such a situation that you cannot do everything on your own. And by understanding this value proposition that is needed to address unmet customer needs, you also understand where to focus on when it comes to open innovation, including external partners and so on. There's a whole blog and an interview with Marco De Polo from Roche Diabetes Care on that example and how this went along. And I would like to invite you to have a look at it and see that on our website. There are also other similar case studies on financial services, on mobility, automotive industry that I'm happy to share with you. Now, need to watch the time, the summary. For the summary, I would like to put in a poll question to you to see what you took away from that, and also as an input for our short Q&A. Now, which of these statements did inspire you the most? And I summarized, so to say, the key messages from that presentation in these four statements. And I'm very happy to see your feedback and how you appreciated that one.
So if you could use the QR code or go to menti.com and enter the digits. So if you use your smartphone, this goes very quickly using the QR code.
Okay, great. Thank you for your votings here. So we can see that, customer needs must be defined independent of solution, gets a very high score. A common understanding of customer needs is the baseline for success. Second highest score and long-term value proposition gets more of the customer's job done better and cheaper. And zero, I can see for customer needs are stable over time and can be measured. That's a very interesting result as well. Maybe I comment a little bit on that feedback that you gave here. I would like to start off with this zero one, customer needs are stable over time and can be measured. This is a very provocative message. I fully understand that. Please put that in a perspective that when we look at the job to be done, like keep blood sugar levels in a range, that is something that people want to do or need to do as a diabetic ever since. And they will have to do this probably also in the future. So therefore, the job is stable over time. And when we look at the outcome statements, like how they measure their success, minimizing the time it takes to get a blood sugar measure value, that will also be valid over time. And what you can see is that what is changing is the solutions. And the solutions will ultimately reduce the time it takes to get a blood sugar level down to zero. Because if you have an automatic sensor, it doesn't take any time for you as a diabetic. So this is how we separate needs and solutions. And by doing so, we can always trace back how well are existing solutions already performing and how much do we need to improve that performance in the future to achieve the expected satisfaction level of the customers. That was a short comment on this. Yeah, customer needs must be defined independent of solutions. I think that is also undermining this message. So thank you very much for your scores here. I would like to show you a final number of slides here. And yeah, you can see the summary again. Now, you will also get a handout of that presentation. If you have questions or comments, I'm very happy to get that from you and to discuss with you. There's also a possibility in the Job to be Done Summit that will happen in March 24, 25. There will also be Marco De Polo from Roche who will do a presentation there from his perspective. We will have people from insurance companies, medical device companies, and also automotive and mobility companies there. They share their viewpoints and their experiences. And there's an innovators talk that we have ramped up here during these hard pandemic times since last March. And I also would like to invite you to join us. It's just a 1 hour virtual talk, no slides, two innovators from different companies talking about customer-centric innovation and their viewpoints and experiences. Now, let me have a look at the chat and if there would be something that we could still go into and I could answer.
Thank you, Martin. Any questions? You can also use your microphones, of course. There's one interesting statement, zero does not mean that it's not true, but the question was whether it inspired people. So the zero does not necessarily mean the statement is not important or not true. It's just not inspiring, maybe.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Sven. Fully agree.
It's not from me, it's from, let me see, it's Maximilian Drenchev. Yeah, it's from the chat. Or another statement with the zero case, some jobs that need to be done today are subject to disruption and can plainly disappear.
I would have a question, Martin, regarding this landscape which you've built up with the hidden segments of opportunity.
Yeah.
How did you do the ranking of importance and satisfaction? Was it like a poll under experts or how did you come up to these values?
Yeah, it was
what was the methodology behind that?
It was actually a questionnaire that went out to approximately 500 job executors. So we do large-scale surveys with typically 200 to 1,000 customers, job executors, to really get a statistically valid and sound result. So it depends on what statistical validity you want to achieve, and depending on that, this defines the size of the sample. But we recommend that you rather go large, rather go high in those numbers, to really make sure that you have a sound and valid understanding of what opportunities are there. And I would also like to go back to what Julia quoted before, that if you want to argue on certain innovations towards the top management in a company who need to advise budgets, you have a very good basis for discussion if you can say this is based on a statistically valid sample of customers and this is how the market really looks like.
Okay, thank you. A very good presentation. I liked it a lot.
Thank you very much.
Martin, I have a question if it's okay. It's Wayne here. Great presentation. One of the challenges I think we have, you talked about partners within the market and serving the user. So one of the challenges we face as a business is whether our competitors, how do we let our competitors in to serve the users and how do we get that balance right? I just wondered if you had any advice on how we could help with that decision or any tips or processes that we could use.
Yeah, that would be part of that quantitative survey. So what you want to do is you want to carve out that questionnaire with all the needs inside, not only to your own customers, but also to those job executors that use competitive solutions. So solutions from your competitors or solutions that are not even out of your industry, but that can also support a specific job. And if you do that, you get a lot of competitive intelligence because you get a feedback from the users, which solutions they like and which solutions can perform on what outcomes better or worse. And based on this competitive intelligence, you right away may go into marketing, into communication, give a briefing to your sales force, because very often you can already argue or put arguments on certain benefits that you have from a customer's point of view that your competition doesn't have. So this is all included in that quantitative approach.
Okay, thank you very much, Martin. There's a comment. I don't know whether it's a comment or a question in the chat, but maybe you can answer this directly in the chat because we have to move on. I just decided that I will copy this chat at the end of the event and just paste it in the document and put this also to the collection of documents of this conference and put it in the community. Because there are so many questions and answers in there, and I think it's interesting to read them again after the event. So I will copy this and publish it, okay?